As Māori women are the most imprisoned demographic of a population in the entire world. And that's, I mean, that is a terrible indictment on Aotearoa.
What does that say to you as a Māori woman?
It says to us, because of what I know about the offending profile, so in other words, what those women have done to be there, what it says to us is that our society and our nation of New Zealand has failed Māori women.
Wairea te rangi e tūnei, wairea te papa e takoto nei, wairea te taumata kōrero ngā mātua kua mene ki te pō tihei, Māori ora e ngā iwi o te motu, nau mai haere mai rā ki te taumata kōrero. Welcome once, welcome twice, welcome three times to the Taumata Kōrero, the podcast, the quintessential space to disseminate a little bit of esoteric knowledge. What, out of 10? Yeah, was that a good intro?
7 to 8.
Oh, yeah. hard lady. E tika ana kia pērā koe, nā te mea e tātou mai he kaupapa nui whakaharahara kua tauiho maira ki te takapau o te wānanga I tēnei wiki. We are getting into one of the most biggest kaupapa I feel that we've taken on the Taumata Kōrero. Joining me today, well actually I'm joining her because nōna kē te whare. So we are in the humble abode of one of the most enlightened Māori women I think I've ever crossed paths with in my 30 years, in my life actually. So I'll throw it across to her. Hei aha māku, ngā kōrero mōna e whakawaha. We'll throw it across to you e te hoa, māu e ki mai, māu e whakamārama mai. Nā wai koe, I ahu mai koe I here. Tell us a bit about yourself and how you're joining us here today.
Oh, kia ora tātou, ko Khylee Quince talking oi, he uri o ngā puhi Ngāti Porou me Ngāti Kahununu hoki. So I'm Khylee Quince, I'm an Associate Professor of Law. I've been a Māori legal academic for 22 years, 18 years at the University of Auckland, and this is my fourth year at AUT. So pretty much Auckland tamaki born and raised, but I come from South Hokianga, so from the Waipoa Nahere round to Pākanai, so that's where my mum's whānau comes from, and my birth father's whānau comes from Tikitiki and also Nuhaka Mahia, so right down to Kahununu country.
There's a few of us that have that that Tai Tokerau Tai Rāwhiti connection, and I think it's the good looking ones and the really smart ones.
Which bit on which side? Yeah,
we'll let the whānau argue take that one. Talk to us about your journey. You've no doubt had some interesting experiences over the last few years. Let's go right back to the start. I want to talk to you about how you got into the space of being a disruptor, being so active in this space.
Well, I think I was known as a bit of a nerd at school. You know, I was good at school, but I didn't do debating or anything like that. I kind of thought that was for, you know, Pākehā kids, really. And but I was good at school, decided to come to law school, and I didn't really know what it was that lawyers did. Yeah. So it actually took a long time to come to the disruptor kind of kaupapa. And I think that was when I really learned about the power of the law. You know, you kind of, I thought that lawyers were just people that earned lots of money and did, you know, could do various things, but it wasn't until quite a long way into it, particularly coming across Whaia Nin Thomas, another, you know, northern woman from Te Rāroa, that she really started to sort of, you know, that kind of speak truth to power about the power of the law to organise society, to change things. And it was really under her tutelage and encouragement, I suppose. Yeah. But in terms of my own life, if you like, as a disruptor, one of the key moments is becoming a mum. Becoming a mum, well, not till I was 30, which is really ancient in my whānau, but becoming a mum, you learn how to, you absolutely, or a parent, not just a mum, but to put other people first, you know, and you know that you can engage full mama bear, papa bear mode for your kids, you know. Yeah. They need to do the right thing, but you fundamentally get what it's like to think about other people first. So that's when I kind of thought, I'll do anything for them.
Yeah.
And I also think I'll do anything for other people's kids too. So not just other people's kids, but other people. It's just, it starts that whakaro, you know.
Do you consider yourself a fighter?
I do now. I don't think I really did before. I was really shy. Like, literally, when I finished law school and I came back to teach at University of Auckland, these were all the same people that had taught me, including, you know, Whāinin, but all the Pākehā people, they're still my teachers, and they didn't know who I was because I never spoke up. I was super quiet. Yeah. I took it all in, and I was just kind of, you know, we have a different timeline to other people, you know, so, you know, literally, waiho mate wa, took me a while to kind of figure, you know, I came from a middle class, pretty privileged background. So to learn empathy for our whānau that didn't have the same kind of privilege as me, that took a while as an adult to really appreciate. So now I think of myself as a fighter, I think. To be honest, I enjoy it, as you say, that kind of northern and coasty whakapapa, you kind of, you're ready for a good scrap, and I like to win.
What is it about the fights that we like? And I'm not talking, you know, actually, at times it is actually fisticuffs, but what is it about the fight that you like?
I think it's the distinction between law and justice. You know, law is rules and regulations. Mm. For Māori, though, tikanga is not rules and regulations. It's about principles and doing the right thing.
Kia ora.
You know, what is the tika thing? So we have a very different orientation and understanding.
Mm.
We think more about justice than we do about rules and regulations. So that's the fight to get to the right thing to do.
Mm.
I don't know. I just think, so what I like about it is, I was raised in quite a religious household. All of my northern whānau, mihinare, and actually most of my coastie whānau too, so they had that very sort of Christian background to that idea of righteousness. But and then you lay the law on top of that and you think, those rules and regulations, they don't work for us, doesn't work for me, I can't see the justness in it. So it's not just justice, but the justness. What is right about that?
Kia ora.
And the way that you treat people and the way that you, you know, shape the lives of our people.
Mm.
So it's that. Doing the, being seen, having a really strong moral compass and being seen to do the right thing.
Yeah. I want to get into our kaupapa. Our kaupapa this week, e hoa mā, Māori and jails. This is something you've spent a lot of time working on, working with, working inside our jails. Mm-hmm. Where are we as Māori in jails? Where on the spectrum are we? We know that there are some damning statistics. Talk me through your initial reaction to that statement, Māori in jails.
So Māori in jails, my inherent kind of reaction to thinking about Māori in jails is that one does not belong in the other.
Kia ora.
You know, that jails are undoubtedly a Pākehā Western concept, that they exist as cages to hold us, to hold the flesh, to hold the wairua, to hold the potential and to squash the potential of tangata Māori. That's what I think of jails. And so, As you've flagged, our relationship with jails, so we didn't have them traditionally. We had other ways of responding to harm and to wrongdoing. So the idea of jails came with the colonizers. The idea and the construction and management of jails came with the colonizers.
Mm.
And our flesh and bones, filled those jails very quickly as a means of management of Māori people, management of people who were seen to be socially unacceptable, dangerous, risky, and you know, and so that's been our whakapapa of interaction with the jail end of the justice system. They've been around for a very long time. We now, you know those statistics. Māori generally are over 50% of people in our prisons. We have a very negative long-term relationship with prisons. Māori women are the most imprisoned demographic of a population in the entire world. And that's, I mean, that is a terrible indictment on Aotearoa.
What does that say to you as a Māori woman?
It says to us, because of what I know about the offending profile, so in other words, what those women have done to be there, what it says to us is that our society and our nation of New Zealand has failed Māori women in terms of an inability to understand our lives and the lives that that those women have been placed in. So one way of putting that in context is to think that, you know, there's been a recent revival of the Manawahine claim in the Waitangi Tribunal, initially filed in 1993 by a powerhouse group of amazing wahine Māori. And it's been revived partly because nothing has gotten better in that 27 years. Many things have gotten much, much worse. So the initial claim was about the effect of colonisation on the mana of Māori woman, the position, our ability to connect to whakapapa, our place in our own whānau, to the fact that from a legal perspective, you know, as Māori woman didn't have legal personality anymore. So the fact that the colonisers brought with them the idea that gender is a really important way of distinguishing between human beings, whereas for us, mana was, not gender. Gender is relevant to roles and responsibilities within whānau and hapori, but not per se in relation to whether or not you're viewed as a human being, whether or not you're able to hold property, to take leadership, rangatira roles. So that diminishment of Māori women made colonisation a vastly different experience for us than it did for Tāne Māori. Because Tāne Māori have a place in the European sort of system of social organisation and law. Māori woman didn't. Māori woman diminished to the status of Pākehā woman, which was not good. So that particular harm and hara was felt differently by our women. So I think our woman's journey to get to prison has been very different to the journey for Māori men.
Have we, in the year 2020, recovered from that? Like when we talk about these this colonisation, have we recovered from it? Are we recovering?
I mean, that's a terribly probably negative and fatalistic thing to say, but the short answer to that is no. And so one piece of evidence we have for that is around the economic position, so the gaps in terms of earning potential, the gaps in terms of education tend to go, you know, the sort of hit chart, if you like, always goes Pākehā men, Māori men, Pākehā woman, Māori woman. So Māori women are always the bottom of the hit parade, no matter what indicator you're talking about. So, and those things have gotten worse. Matua Moana Jackson is about to release his updated 30-year report on he whai pāngahō, Māori in the criminal justice system. The thing that's gotten worse in the 30 years between his initial report and his update is really the socioeconomic position of Māori. Pōharatanga is much, much worse. You know, 30 years ago, we were talking about Māori and disconnection from Māoritanga, you know, from te ao Māori. So in the 1980s, the people he was talking to were people that this is pre-kura kaupapa Māori, this is pre-Māori TV and broadcasting, pre-Māori health initiatives. So it was a very different society, 1980s New Zealand. The 30 years since, some of those gains have been made in terms of the reo, in terms of our place and importance within our communities, but actually the gaps in economic terms, those have gone wider. So now, for example, so a big difference is that I can go into a prison. I will talk to a lot of rangatahi Māori, particularly young men. They speak the reo. They know exactly who they are. They know exactly where they come from. They have relationships with their whānau, their hapū, their iwi, but they're poor. But every one of them is disconnected from education. Very few of them have skills that are going to really uplift their whānau to acceptable income levels, where crime and offending behaviours aren't high risk pathways for them to choose. So we've begun to address some of the cultural and spiritual harm of colonisation, but not the economic basis that puts us in the position of being poor people in our own territory. That hasn't happened.
Why, in your opinion, have successive governments failed to protect the interests of Māori, thus leading us to be at the bottom of the hit list, as you say, that it goes, that, you know, it goes Pākehā men, Pākehā woman, Māori woman.
Good question. Partly, I mean, if you think, if you know anything about New Zealand politics and its response to Māori, so that's obviously where law and policy comes from. If we look back to, so for one, we're talking about post-World War II urbanisation, so the mass urbanisation of Māori in a very short period of time. And then we have the public response to that mobile population with reports like the Pritchard Report and the Hun Report. So beginning to think about how do we characterise and respond to the Māori population in an assimilationist sense. So they will be similar to us, so we treat them equally as we would non-Māori citizens. Yep. In an integrationist sense, or are they special? So we had one generation post-war where there was that, well, we'll actually try and treat you like we treat everybody else.
Okay.
So we lost our specialness as tangata whenua. Then by the 1970s, of course, we had our parents and grandparents who were like, hey, what about our special status? What about our treaty partner status? So they learned from the American Indian movement. They learned from the Black Panther movement, this idea of Indigenous Renaissance and of minority Renaissance. So then we had the sort of, well, we've got to revive the cultural aspect. And so government policy has had to track those social movements. So integrationist movements, then to, oh, well, we'll fix cultural disconnection. And then we got to the 1980s and early 1990s where we had what some commentators have called like indigenisation. So well, we'll give every government department a Māori name.
Sure.
You'll have to learn how to do a whakatau for new staff. There'll be a departmental waiata. You'll have a Māori advisory group and a Māori strategy. And so we've had these different sort of iterations or generations of the ways in which we've responded to Māori. And I think we're on a tipping point now with this particular government. National is always going to be on the integrationist end of the, you know, you need to survive as citizens.
Yep.
Labour and left-wing politics is a bit more difficult. They want to respond to us partly on the economic basis. Mm. So we'll respond. That's where the closing the gaps for Kārō came at the end of the 1990s.
Yep.
But closing the gaps in an economic sense fails to recognise us as tangata whenua. So you need to do both of those things.
Mm.
So I think we're on a tipping point of the government, and I don't mean the specific government, but government generally, understanding that you need to look at us in both senses. And it's about the Article 2 and Article 3 interplay in terms of treaty talk, right?
Yep.
So Article 2, tino ranga tiratanga, self-determination. You can't self-determine if you've got nothing.
Mm.
Self-determining without the pūtia, nothing.
Yep.
Giving people the you know, equality status, which is the Article 3 kōrero, that misses out on the fact that we're different. So they need to respond to us in both senses. So, and I think we're just on the tipping point of government in the big sense and the Crown finally understanding that's what it means to be a good treaty partner. You've got to treat us equally, but also differently.
Mm.
And it's taken them a really long time to understand that, I think.
How far are we away from going over the edge from the government finally coming to that understanding? Reaching that tipping point?
I think one of the potential circuit breakers, it certainly hasn't come to play so far, but one of the potential circuit breakers was this government establishing that special, specific agency, Te Ara Whiti. So and that whole agency is around building the Crown capacity to be a better treaty partner. So across the board, whatever agency you're talking about, police, corrections, health, housing, yep. education, all of it, how can we build our capacity to be a better treaty partner?
Mm.
And that is the potential to be a circuit breaker. So the sort of devolution of the old Māori affairs was quite harmful in that sense, is that it left each individual agency to scrap it out for themselves in terms of Māori capacity, because Te Puni Kōkiri doesn't do that job. So the fact that now Corrections has to find its own Rautaki Māori, its own Māori advisory group, and then so does Education and so does Health. Well, actually, they need to... We're a pretty limited kind of, you know, capacity group, really. You end up with the same people doing the same mahi for like 10 different outfits and you kind of end up with a watered down, you know, perhaps from the Crown's perspective, maybe quite convenient divide and rule strategy. So that needs to be brought together. So Te Ara Whiti has the potential to do that.
I want to take you inside the jails, our jails. I know you've spent a lot of time talking with the men and women, Māori men and women incarcerated at the moment. Talk to me about the things that you've seen about those people. So let's start talking about the human traits of those Māori that are behind in jail right now.
So there are. So the first thing I would say is that, generally speaking, as a result of what I've already flagged, the Māori woman experience is very different to the Māori men's experience. Māori men make up the overwhelming number of mohere, of inmates. Mm. Their experience, so one connector that's also really pertinent to sort of contemporary times is the background of welfare intervention. So so we know at the moment we've got the Royal Commission of Inquiry into Abuse in State Care. About three quarters of all Māori inmates have a state care background. So, and the older you are, the more likely that background means that you were actually physically removed from your whānau and taken to an institution. Wow. When we talk about state care in the modern sense, so when we say that, you know, the children in Oranga Tamariki care, people who are sort of 30 and under, most of them haven't been removed into institutions. Institutions tend to close at the late 1980s. They've been removed into other whānau, quite often non-Māori whānau. But for older inmates, many of those men in particular talk about being placed into the institutions, Hokio Beach, Owairaka down the road here, so the big institutions. Younger people have either been placed into, many of them have been placed into welfare homes, so to other whānau, but the experience is the same. It's an experience of disconnection from family, and none of it has been a positive experience. I haven't heard a single person talk about a positive experience. One experience that really affected me, and you're talking about hearing some really, really harmful mamai, really harmful disclosures of abuse and victimisation. But one of the ones that really affected me, because it was about the normalisation of prison, was a 50-year-old Ngāpuhi man that I met in Mount Eden prison. And just to sort of establish, you know, a connection with him, I asked him, you know, how his cell was, who he was, you know, bunking with, and whether it was all good. And he goes, oh, yeah, yes, it's all good. My Sally is my bro that I met when I was 8, 42 years ago, when we shared a room at Owairaka Boys Home. And that really hurt me. I'm like, man, you have a 42-year relationship with a dude, and all the kids, even the young people have the same relationship with their brothers and sisters. They call their whānau from Korowai Manaaki, from Weymouth or from Rotorua or Palmerston North. So first thing is that care and protection background. Almost all, I've not come across, particularly for boys and men, anyone that has survived past third form. So in third form in the old language, for people like me, year nine, almost everybody has a disconnection from kura, from formal education, by the age of 13. Presence of drugs and alcohol in the whānau, and also in their own personal experience, most inmates have used and have abused their tinana by the age of 10 to 12. And we're talking about hard drug use by 13, so methamphetamine generally, class A drugs by age 13. So a lot of victimisation, harming of others, but terrible, terrible harms that have been perpetrated upon them. Yeah. Mostly a whakapapa of violence in their own whānau too, so extreme violence by family members, a long thread of fatherlessness, of disconnection from positive male role models. For women, offending is always connected to a man. For women, offending is always connected to a man. So whether it's a whānau type of offending, so To brothers, to husbands, to partners, or to their own immediate whānau, but almost always to a man. And a lot of, for women, again, violence, but usually as the sufferer of violence, as the men do too, but in terms of partnership, women, very strong histories of victimisation.
Mm. It's... It's haunting, actually, hearing these real life situations that are lived experiences by our Māori people. And, you know, hearing you talk about that, it makes me really feel that there are a lot of us, and I know a lot of the demographic that will be watching this, we live in a bubble. We live in a safe space where, you know, this is the reality for some of our whānau, some of our whanaunga out there are going through this. How do we actively engage with one another to kind of, you know, put a stop to this or at least try and impact this in some way?
Yeah, good pātai. So, you know, I think we take advantage of the spotlight that Black Lives Matter brings to our local situation. So one is to highlight amongst our own whānau and broader communities, so non-Māori communities here, that harm that we can really, that's quite exotic, you know, and I think people think that that doesn't happen here, and it does. So one is to share that kōrero as widely as you can. Mm. You know, and also to think about how violence has been perpetuated, not just by the police, but by all Crown agencies on us. So that's one. And to, you know, to think about, you know, this is an election year. Your vote counts. So, you know, we had a win in recent weeks with the passing of the prisoner voting rights. Sure. I gave evidence at the tribunal for that claim. And it's really to think about the connection between, you know, sometimes it's not that we're apathetic, but it's really hard, again, to be an engaged political citizen when you're living a hand-to-mouth life of survival. Mm. So, again, so that's what I think that partly might, because sometimes you feel a bit hakama to like go in and talk for these people, you know, think I'm like a, you know, I look like a respectable middle class, like Pākehā woman, like, yeah, you know, what right do you have to go and talk about this stuff? But actually I think that's part of my privilege is that I get paid a good salary. I have the time, space and words literally to be able to do that mahi. And so one of the things for actual, you know, the people on the ground to do to change that and not to be talked about but to be active citizens is to enroll to vote, you know, and to you not to be so dismissive of the power of the franchise, you know, the power of the franchise. Our single biggest budgetary item for the past 3 years' budget, so not just for this government but for the previous national government, was corrections, was prisons. $799 million. Imagine if we had that money in the Hokianga, if we had that money in Te Tai Rāwhiti, if we had that money for health, for housing, you know, that's a huge amount of money. They're spending more money housing tangata Māori in prisons than they are on Māori housing. Now, that is a terrible thing. Mm. So the other thing I want people to think about is that one of the things that I also find incredibly offensive and makes me so angry is when I hear our people in prison, A, not only do they think it's normal and it's comfortable, but for women in particular, it's safe. They will say to your face when I say, oh, because in my mind, of course, and I think to most citizens' minds, being in prison would be like the worst thing that could ever happen to you.
Yeah.
Well, what kind of life are you living if you think it's not? Because I've got a bed, I get fed. I interviewed a woman last year who was thrilled with the fact that she got her teeth replaced, that she got her health needs seen to, because being in prison has, you know, you have access to these things that they don't have on the outs, as they call it, on the outs.
Yeah.
That is disgusting. We should not accept that. We should not accept that our women feel safer in prison than they do on the outside, that our men feel you know, some of the lack of, you know, they feel the weight of responsibility of managing for their whānau by being on the inside. Because that's one of the other core differences in the way that men and women experience prison. When men go to prison, there's usually a woman or some woman that are still managing their lives outside. They keep the whare running, they keep the whānau running, whether it's your mum or your sisters or your aunties or your partner. For women, women do their time alone. Māori women do their time alone, Pākehā women do their time alone. They refuse visits, but they continue to manage their children and their whānau, and quite often they manage their man from inside prison in ways that men don't. They're astonishingly well-organised and political in that sense that they, you know, they continue to be the heads of families inside. It's amazing.
What's that like, hearing those stories? Because I think this is a level of discussion that we don't hear. We don't hear the voice of an incarcerated Māori woman. What's that like? Hearing that is, like, in my mind, I'm going, well, she's controlling the whānau, the whānau unit from behind bars. We don't hear that voice, but because we don't hear that voice.
I think that's something people need to think about, is that sometimes we think of prisoners as either being bad people or koretake in some way, like you couldn't get your shit together, so you ended up having to steal stuff, or you know, you had to manage your life by committing crime. Women, and I don't think this sounds sexist, I think that is the lived experience, quite often make much more calculated. It's a capability, you know, the ability to actually see beyond the cage of the hinaki of the prison, to continue your relationships with people and to manage relationships. You know, you see women get on the phone card inside and they're ringing kāinga ora, oranga tamariki, kura. They do their meet the teachers phone calls in relation to their kids in kura. The prison is just, that's where they're living, but they're still living their lives. That it's an amazing capability of wāhine Māori to be able to do that. Men kind of take it as a bit of a holiday, and life goes on because they've got the woman outside doing that that mahi for them. And so we could tap into that potential, the potential of women to continue to the thing that holds them back, to continue to lead their lives and to you know, to be good mothers and aunties and nannies inside, and to be supportive of each other inside. We could tap into that potential when they are outside, you know, to be good peer leaders and whānau leaders for others. And I think you just need to look past those bars and see what are you doing? Yeah, and that's, you know, we talk about it in particularly in education, you know, you talk about looking beyond deficit. Yep. And the deficit lens that we take to inmates is that you're either a bad person, you're a dangerous person. And in relation to women, it's that you chose a really useless partner. So we often think about the narrative of choice, as if people made choices, that's what offending sort of theory tends to be about, that you chose this life of crime and you knew the difference between right and wrong. Actually, people need to realise many of these people did not. Yeah. They didn't have much choice, particularly for wāhine Māori that are in partnership with gang-affiliated men, there's very little choice. If you're in a gang-affiliated whānau, quite often that choice is made for you. I've lost count of the number of women that will just say, at age 13, I was told that I was his. That's not choice. And you end up in a 30-year relationship so it is kind of like being tumored, but in quite a negative and quite dangerous, risky sense. But with the same weight of expectation that we would place on a traditional arrangement.
Kia ora.
So it is a bastardization of a tikanga, but it is one that gang women continue.
And it's interesting you bring up the concept of bastardization of tikanga, because that's essentially that's what it comes back to for me, is that our tikanga Māori, it's a perpetuation of that bastardization of not only tikanga Māori, but everything Māori, and it comes back to these jails. That's all it comes back to. What's your take on that?
Absolutely. So, you know, I talked about that concept of indigenization, yeah. which was kind of like the bastardization of acceptable parts of tikanga, the things that aren't particularly challenging to the crown or Te Ao Pākehā. We will take those things. And, you know, so remember back in the 1980s again when John Rangiho was chairing the Pu'au Tiatatu kaupapa. Remember he said in there, putting a carving above the door does not make that space Māori.
Mm.
Putting a carving above the door does not make that space Māori. Mm. I don't care what Ngāwhā looks like. I don't care what Waikerea looks like. I don't care what any of those spaces look like. You can have a Māori focus unit. You can have a whare. You can learn raranga, you can learn whakaido, they can have whānau days where the boys learn how to make hāngi. It is not a Māori space. Those are not places. I'm happy for those people to do those things, to make that experience more acceptable to them, but we cannot accept that that makes it a Māori space. It is not. Mm. We do not have those spaces. We have different ways of responding to those harms.
Mm.
I do still find it offensive that these are spaces where some of those people and a lot of those people, and I mean mohere, I mean inmates, they are learning those things for the first time. That really hurts my heart to think that you learnt, you know what I mean, when you go into a whare and you see, how am I going to describe it for a non-visual? You know, you see the prison carving. It's 8x8. You know exactly the size. It's a square photo frame. You know that it's an MDF thing. That's their first piece.
Yeah.
So you go into a whare and you see that where you've got four kids or your nannies in one of those frames and you think, that's a prison. That's your prison whakaero learning. You didn't learn that in Rotorua. You didn't learn that, you know, on the outs. So you know that that journey for you started there. That's a terrible thing, you know, that you learnt or that your first experience of the reo inside, that's a terrible thing. Mm. And yet having said that, one of the most, I think, profound experiences I've had as a teacher in 22 years, so taking some students in and out a couple of years ago when I took a group of students down to Waikerea to the Māori focus unit for those, I mean, kids, Māori kids that go to university, for the most part, you know, they're quite middle class and quite insulated in that bubble you mentioned. And it was really confronting to all of us to be surrounded by all of these tāne Māori tattered up, looking quite tough, and we shared a kai together and they huckered for us, and it was profound. It was like a life-changing experience for almost everybody there to see, you know, how privileged we were. And yet these were our relations, literally our relations. It was a really phenomenal experience, and because they were as weary of us as we are of them, and that's, you know, we don't want to see those gaps between us and them, because we are all, we are whānau, and yet one of those gaps, we often talk about gaps between Māori and non-Māori.
Mm.
We do not need or want to see the haves and have-nots within our own communities, and to have people that are disconnected from healthy, functioning whānau, hapū and other community supports for them amongst our own.
Mm.
We see that in kōti rangatahi, people that are too embarrassed to come. They say, I'd rather go to court. I'd rather go to court, miss. I don't want to go on marae and be exposed. My dad doesn't want us to come to court, doesn't want us to come to the marae because he doesn't know what to do. That's a terrible thing, that you're more comfortable in a Māori focus unit in prison or in, you know, D block than you are in a marae. We should never accept that.
That's sad, really sad that, you know, that our whānau, and you touched on those of us who have lived somewhat had an insular upbringing, living in a bubble, that there are still some of our whānau that feel more comfortable, you know, in a courtroom in D block than they do on our marae or tātou marae.
Aye.
Our marae, my marae, your marae, their marae.
Mm-hmm.
I want to start wrapping us up, e te tuahine, and what I'm going to ask of you is to provide let's say three pathways, three things that our audience can take away from this, and you've touched on this a few times, is how we go about re-indigenizing the space that our whānau, that our brothers, our uncles, our fathers, our sons, our aunties, our Māori whanaunga, whanaunga Māori in prisons. How do we go about re-indigenizing the space to make that experience more comfortable for them?
So one, I'm not sure that I'd agree that we should.
Okay. Let's talk through that.
Yeah. So, and that's the, you know, on the spectrum of sort of Māori thought and politics, there's the, you know, do we deal with the here and now, or do we talk about the dreaming, you know, decarceration, abolition of prisons? And so the first thing I would say is that those things are not mutually exclusive. I hold that whakaaro very dearly, is that I 100% support Matua Moana, Tracy McIntosh, Kim Workman, my mate Julia Faipoti, in being strong holders of the decarceration kaupapa, meaning by decarceration, keeping Māori out of prisons and actually abolishing prisons as a response to wrongdoing. But I would also say that is not to say that in the meantime, if that's the dreaming, if that's the ultimate objective, we can't forget about the people who are here and now. 5,000 Māori people that woke up this morning in a cage. 5,000 people. So you need to think about how do we make them it okay for them without losing sight of the long objective. So one is to support policies and parties. So politics and non-government organisations and your iwi social services, for example.
Kia ora.
So, for example, you know, my whanaunga at Ngāpuhi Iwi Social Services, they've got some things going in terms of how do we keep people out? We know that, for example, bail addresses is a problem. So let's buy up some whare in Kaikoura so that young people don't have to go and wait in prison for their matters to be heard. Yeah. Similarly in Kaitaia, we know Ricky Houghton and others are doing in terms of, you know, so making things better on the outside as options or choices. So make those things known to yourself. You know, what are things that we can do that increase the options for Māori that do come into contact with justice processes? That's the first thing. Then two, to learn more about that big goal stuff, you know, to learn about the dreaming. And I will say, you know, until not that many years ago, I thought that people that talked about prison abolition were on the loop-de-loop, you know, lunatic fringe. You know, it's like, but what about the, you know, the seriously cray-cray porangi people? What do we do with them? So think about that. Read Angela Davis, read Sid Jackson, read Matua Moana, you know. Look into what does that mean? What is that, in the same way that we should be thinking about those things in relation to tamariki Māori and oranga tamariki. When we talk about whānau empowerment in that space, what does that look like in terms of responding to harm that's done in our own communities? So one, use your vote and knowledge, you know, school yourself up in relation to what we can do in terms of making prison better. Our mate Kingi Snellgar recently did an OIA search in relation to what is that corrections budget, you know, $799 million. What is it spent on? Because you might be thinking, oh, well, because Māori are 50% of the prison population, 50% of that must be for us, and a really big amount of that proportion of that must be for programming, for, you know, Māori programming. Ka hore, 3%. 3% of the programming budget, which is a small percent of that $799, was for programming. Again, the devil is in the details. What exactly are you supporting? If you're supporting parties that have that as a policy, so be politicised is my big whakaaro, I suppose, both in terms of the immediate spend and policies, but also what do they want in the long run?
Yeah.
This government's talked about 30% decarceration over 15 years, so that means 30% lower prison population. Well, the latest projections have showed that the remand is blowing out and that the prison population is going to almost double within the next decade. So that didn't work. So what are they doing to try and change that? So be aware is the main thing, and make your choices about, you know, who you vote for and what your public position is in your kōrero at the dinner table. Really, really important. Yeah. Having hard conversations. Be a Pākehā whisperer. You know, try like and change. That. You know, I kind of think that's kind of my daily job, you know, as I'm trying to explain to Pākehā what this is like. You know, what is it that you don't know about our experience and the way that we would want to do things, that the way that we think, the way that we are, the way that we, you know, our being, how is that different from the way that you think about wrongdoing, about whānau, about health, all of those things in a challenging but, you know, partnership kind of way, you know?
I like that. Be a Pākehā whisperer. That's good.
Kiha Karen. You know, take on Kiha Karen.
I'm going to wrap us up. We're going to throw to the Waiata of the Week. And I was listening to the song actually as we were driving out here. And I thought, gee, this is actually quite fitting. So we're going to throw to our Waiata of the Week. And you might know the lead singer of, it's a bit of a throwback. It's Aotearoa and their song Maranga Ake. You might be able to tell us a bit about this when we come back. This is their song on the Taumata Kōrero. E te iwi, kia mau tonu mai rā.
Maranga ake ai. There's a movement on the street. People moving, the shepherd to freedom from oppression, 'cause that's what my people need. So when you hear me, Maranga ake ai, akwane, Maranga ake ai, I said it soon come now. How much longer on talking? A million miles already and we still go walking. All my life I get taught about the right of the great right way. I said how much longer before we get up and say what people Maranga ake ai.
E tātou mā koe rā ko te Waiata Maranga ake ai nā te pēne rongonui nei Aotearoa. Bit of a jam, bit of a throwback. And you were just saying that, you know those two larrikins in there, te tuhine.
So of course, Justice Joe, or Sir Justice Joseph Victor Williams. So yes, like the peak, if you like, you know, the whatukura of the Māori legal community, I suppose, right up there with Matua Joe, wrote that song, got to the lofty heights of number two on the New Zealand charts back in the 80s. Check out the video online, people. It's a testament to 1980s leisure wear, pre-Jordans. So it's great. But it's a message that resonates throughout the ages, you know, like wake up, get up. You know, that's the sort of message of being politicised, whether you're talking about the reo, the law, health, you know, and he's been, he and they in different ways, you know, he's been an absolute champion of how do we hold our space as Māori, but better than hold our space, how do we push forward to that dreaming kaupapa of tino rangatiratanga. So shout out to you, Judge Joe. We love him. And he's right at the lofty heights of the Supreme Court and continuing. And, of course, my iwi te Roroa, we were his first clients when he was a lawyer. So we have a good relationship with him on that front too.
I just want to throw it back to you. Let's start wrapping things up. If there's any final words that you wanted to say with regards to this kaupapa, Māori and jails. We've had an awesome kōrero, but no doubt you've got some final sentiments that you wanted to leave us with on the podcast today.
I suppose it's not settling. I think that's the big thing. Be disruptive. Don't accept that things have to be as they are. You know, one of our sort of international leaders in this space, Professor Angela Davis, you know, recently said in relation to the Black Lives Matter movement, and she's been talking about this for 50 years, you know, as a member of the Black Panthers and as a long-term disruptor. Never, the greatest gift that we can give to young people is the confidence, the courage, and the ability to question what you thought was unquestionable. The courage, the power, the confidence, and the ability to question what you thought was unquestionable. We accept that prison is an acceptable way of responding to wrongdoing. We don't have to accept that.
Kia ora.
I think that's probably the final word. Let's leave it with Sister Angela. Question the unquestionable.
Awesome. Question the unquestionable. That is a beautiful kōrero to go out on. So e te iwi, that is the Taumata Kōrero done and dusted for another week. E te tuahine, e te rangatira, e mihi nui ana me te aroha o tōku ngākau ki a koe. Mōwi whakapuare mai tō whare. Tō koutou whare, tō tātou whare, ki te kaupapa nei, ki te taumata kōrero i tēnei rā, e mihi nui ana ki a koe. O tira, kia koutou katoa, e mātakitaki mai ana, e whakarongo mai ana, e mihi ana kia koutou katoa. Let's keep the wānanga going. You can find us on Facebook, The Taumata Kōrero. You can also find us on Instagram, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and any other place you get your podcasts. You can find us there. You can also find us in our latest collaboration with Renews at TVNZ, renews.co.nz, tvnz.co.nz. And let's keep the wānanga going. Let's keep this rolling. Kia hoki anō rā ki ērā kupu rongonui rā wātu e tātou mā. Mō tēnei wā, ko te pō e ka tau, tēnei rā ko te taumata kōrero. Ka huri.